Allow me to begin on a personal note. This is a picture taken of me right around the time that my grandmother was diagnosed with end-stage heart disease and sent home to die. She already had so many bypass surgeries and basically run out of plumbing, get so scarred up inside. Could find a wheelchair, crushing chest pain. Her life was over at age 65. Then she heard about this guy, Nathan Pritikin, one of our early lifestyle medicine pioneers. And what happened next is detailed in Pritikin's biography. My grandma was one of the death's door people, Francis Greger. My grandma arrived in one of his early sessions in a wheelchair. Mrs. Greger had heart disease, angina, clot, occasion her condition so bad she could no longer walk without great pain in her chest and legs. Within 3 weeks, though, she was not only out of her wheelchair, but she was walking 10 miles a day. This is a picture of my grandma at her grandson's wedding. 15 years after the doctors had abandoned her to die, she was given her medical death sentence at age 65, thanks to a healthy diet, was able to enjoy another 31 years on this planet till age 96. To enjoy her 6 grandkids, including me. That's why I went into medicine. Now, years later, when Dr. Dean Ornish published his lifestyle heart trial, proving with something called quantitative angiography that indeed heart disease could be reversed, arteries opened up without drugs, without surgery, in the majority of patients, with a plant-based diet and other healthy lifestyle behaviors, I assumed this was going to be the game changer. I mean, my family had seen it with their own eyes, but here it was, in black and white, published in some of the most prestigious medical journals in the world, yet nothing happened. So wait a second, effectively the cure to our number one killer could get lost down some rabbit hole and ignored. What else might there be in the medical literature that, you know, could help my patients but didn't have a corporate budget driving its promotion? Well, I made it my life's mission to find out. For those of you unfamiliar with my work, every year I read through every issue of every English language nutrition journal in the world, so busy folks like you don't have to. Very nice. I then compile all the most interesting, most groundbreaking, most practical findings into new videos I upload to my nonprofit site, nutritionfacts.org. Everything on the website is free. There are no ads, no corporate sponsorships, strictly non-commercial, not selling anything. Just put it up as a public service, as a labor of love, as a tribute to my grandmother. New videos and articles every day on the latest in evidence-based nutrition. What a concept. So where did Pritikin get his evidence from? Well, a network of missionary hospitals set up throughout sub-Saharan Africa uncovered what may be one of the greatest medical advances, according to one of the greatest medical figures of the 20th century, Dr. Dennis Burkitt, the fact that many of our major and commonest diseases were universally rare, like heart disease. In the African population of Uganda, for example, coronary heart disease almost non-existent. You say, wait a second. Our number one killer almost non-existent. What were they eating? Well, they're eating lots of vegetables and grains and greens, and their protein almost exclusively from plant sources. And they had the cholesterol levels to prove it, very similar to what one sees in kind of modern day plant eaters. So wait a second, maybe Africans were just dying early from something else, never lived long enough to get a heart attack. No, here's age-matched heart attack rates in Uganda versus St. Louis. Out of 632 autopsies in Uganda, only one myocardial infarction. Out of 632 age and gender matched autopsies in Missouri, 136 myocardial infarctions, more than 100 times the rate of our leading killer. In fact, they were so blown away, they went back, did another 800 autopsies in Uganda. Still, just that one small healed infarct, meaning it wasn't even the cause of death. Out of 1,427 patients, less than one in 1,000. Whereas here, heart disease is an epidemic. Atherosclerosis, hardening of the arteries, is a disease that begins in childhood. By age 10, nearly all kids raised on the standard American diet already have what are called fatty streaks in their arteries, which is the first stage of the disease, which then can turn into plaques in our 20s, get worse in our 30s, and then can start killing us all. So if there's anyone here today older than age 10, then the question isn't whether or not to eat healthy to prevent heart disease, it's whether you want to reverse the heart disease you likely already have. Is that even possible? You know, when researchers took people with heart disease, put them on the kind of plant-based diet followed by populations that did not get heart disease, their hope was that maybe they could slow the disease process down. Maybe even stop it. But instead, something miraculous happened. As soon as people stopped eating artery-clogging diets, their bodies were able to start dissolving some of this plaque away, opening up arteries without drugs, without surgery, suggesting their bodies wanted to be healthy all along, but were just never given the chance. This remarkable improvement in blood flow to the actual heart muscle itself was after just 3 weeks eating healthy. This is nothing new. We've known about this for decades. American Heart Journal, 1977, cases like Mr. F.W. here, heart disease so bad, couldn't even make it to the mailbox. Started eating healthier. A few months later, he was climbing mountains, no pain. Now, there are these fancy new anti-angina drugs on the market now, cost thousands of dollars a year, but hey, at the highest dose, may be able to extend exercise duration as long as 33 and a half seconds. It does not look like those choosing the drug route are going to be climbing mountains anytime soon. See, plant-based diets aren't just safer and cheaper, they can work better because you're treating the actual cause of the disease. Normally, I'd go through all 15 leading causes of death, but because of the short time slot here, I'm going to skip down to killer number 7. Type 2 diabetes, a disease we've known we can help prevent, treat, and reverse with a plant-based diet, something we've known since the 1930s. Put people on a plant-based diet, diabetics on a plant-based diet, within 5 years, a quarter of the diabetics were off of all their insulin altogether. But hey, I mean, plant-based diets are, in general, relatively low-calorie diets. Maybe their diabetes just got so much better because they lost so much weight. I mean, to tease that out, what you'd have to do is take people, right, put half of them on a healthy diet, but force them to eat so much food that they don't lose any weight. Then we could see if there's specific benefits to plant-based diets beyond just all the easy weight loss. All right. Well, we'd have to wait a few decades, but here it is. Subjects were weighed every day. They started to lose weight. They were made to eat more food. In fact, so much more food, some of the participants have problems eating it all. They're like, oh, not another salad. Oh. But eventually, they adapted, so no weight loss despite restricting meat, eggs, dairy, and junk food. Say, okay, well, wait a second. With zero weight loss, was there still any benefit for their diabetes? Well, insulin needs were cut 60%, and half the diabetics ended off all their insulin altogether. Wow, how many years did this take? No, 16 days. 16 days later. So we're talking people who've had diabetes for 20 years, injecting 20 units of insulin a day, and then 13 days later on none. Diabetes for 20 years, and then off all insulin in less than 2 weeks. Diabetes for 20 years because no one had told her about a plant-based diet. Here's participant number 15. 32 units of insulin on the control diet, and then 18 days later on none. Lower blood sugars on 32 units less insulin. That's the power of plants. And as a bonus, their cholesterol dropped like a rock to under 150, again, in only about 2 weeks. So, you know, just like modest changes in diet will only give you modest benefits for cholesterol reduction, how modest do you want your diabetes? You know, moderation in all things is not necessarily a good thing, right? Asking diabetics to make moderate changes in their diet can leave them with moderate blindness, moderate kidney failure, moderate amputation, maybe just a few toes or something. Everything in moderation may be a truer statement than many people realize, right? There was a study published recently which was reported as diets high in meat, eggs, and dairy can be harmful to health of smoking, suggesting that those in middle age who eat lots of meat, animal protein, meat, egg, white, and dairy protein, four times as likely to die from cancer or diabetes. But if you look at the actual study, you'll see that's simply not true. Those who eat lots of animal protein in middle age don't have four times the likelihood of dying from diabetes. They had 73 times the risk of dying from diabetes. Now, those that chose moderation, only eating a moderate amount of animal protein, oh, they just had 23 times the risk of death from diabetes. The academic institution where the study was done sent out a press release with a memorable opening line: that chicken wing you're eating could be as deadly as a cigarette, they said, explaining that, you know, eating lots of animal protein during middle age approximately quadruples one's risk of dying from cancer, which is comparable to what one might get smoking cigarettes. So what was the reaction within the nutrition community to this revelation that diets high in meat, eggs, and dairy could be harmful to health of smoking? Well, one nutrition scientist says it was potentially dangerous to tell people about this study. Why? Because a smoker might think, hey, why bother quitting smoking if my ham and cheese sandwich is just as bad for me? So let's not tell anyone about this meat and cheese. Shh. Reminds me of this famous Philip Morris cigarette ad that tried to downplay the risk by saying, hey, you think secondhand smoke is bad, increasing the risk of lung cancer 19%. Well, hey, drinking one or two glasses of milk every day, maybe three times as bad, 62% increased risk of lung cancer. Or doubling your risk frequently cooking with oil. Or tripling your risk of heart disease by eating non-vegetarian. Or multiplying your risk sixfold if you eat lots of meat and dairy. So, they conclude, let's keep some perspective here. The risk from secondhand smoke may be well below that of other everyday activities, so breathe deep. That's like saying, yeah, don't worry about getting stabbed, because getting shot's so much worse. How about neither? Two risks don't make a right. Of course, you'll note that Philip Morris stopped throwing dairy under the bus once they purchased Kraft Foods. Just saying. Killer number 13, high blood pressure, currently affecting 78 million American adults. That's one in three adults in this country. And as we get older, our pressures get higher and higher, such that by age 60, the majority of folks in this country have high blood pressure. You say, wait a second. If most of us get high blood pressure when we get older, maybe it's less a disease and more just an inevitable consequence of aging. No. We've known since the 1920s that high blood pressure need not occur. Blood pressure is measured among 1,000 rural Kenyans who ate a diet centered around grains and beans and vegetables and fruits and greens. Our blood pressures go up. As we age, their blood pressures go down. And the lower, the better. We now have evidence to suggest that even people with a blood pressure of 120 over 80, if you went to your doctor with a blood pressure 120 over 80, you'd get a gold star. But now there's evidence even people under 120 over 80 may benefit from blood pressure reduction. So the ideal blood pressure, the no benefit from reducing it further blood pressure, 110 over 70. 110 over, I mean, is it even possible to get pressures down to 110 over 70? It's not just possible, it's normal for those eating healthy enough diets. Over a few year period at this rural Kenyan hospital, 1,800 patients were admitted. How many cases of high blood pressure did they find? Zero. Wow, they must have had low rates of heart disease, right? No, they had no rates of heart disease. Not a single case of atherosclerosis, our number one killer, was found. Rural China, same thing. About 110 over 70 their entire life. 70-year-olds, same average blood pressure as 16-year-olds. These are basic African diet, Asian diet, vastly different, but what they shared in common is that they were plant-based day-to-day with meat only eaten on special occasions. So wait a second, why do we think it's the plant-based nature of their diet that was so protected, that was the magical ingredient? Because in the Western world, according to the American Heart Association, the only folks really getting it down that low were those eating strictly plant-based diets, coming in at an average of 110 over 65. This is the largest study of plant-based eaters in the world, actually. Based on 89,000 Californians. This is actually done primarily around Loma Linda, California. There's actually a Loma Linda table here, I was excited to see. So this is comparing disease rates among non-vegetarians. It's kind of hard to, we're cut off a little bit. Versus those Emmy vegetarians. You gotta buy that. They do great in movies, let me just tell you. Is that the Emmys? Those are the Oscars. What am I? All right. Music. Something. Comparing those that are non-vegetarian to those that are so-called semi-vegetarians, flexitarians, those that eat meat more on a weekly basis, a few times a week rather than a few times a day, compared to those that eat no meat except fish, compared to those who eat no meat at all, compared to those who eat no meat and dairy. And as you can see, there's this stepwise drop of high blood pressure rates the more and more plant-based ones get. Same thing with type 2 diabetes, the same thing with obesity. So sure, you can throw the vast majority of your risk for these killer diseases out the window by eating strictly plant-based, but what I want to emphasize about this slide is it's not black or white, it's not all or nothing. Any movement we can make along the spectrum towards eating healthier will accrue significant health benefits. For blood pressure, you can show this experimentally. You take vegetarians, you give them meat, pay them enough to eat it, their blood pressure goes up. Or you take people who already eat meat, remove meat from their diet, their blood pressures go down. within 7 days. And these remarkable results were after most had to stop taking their blood pressure medications or dramatically reduce their blood pressure medications, because if you treat the cause of their disease, you can't have normal blood pressures and still be on blood pressure meds. You'll drop your blood pressure too low. So lower pressures on fewer drugs. That's the power of plans. So, does the American Heart Association recommend a no-meat diet? No, they recommend this low-meat diet, the so-called DASH diet, created with the goal to lower blood pressure. So wait a second, why not strictly plant-based? When the DASH diet was created, were they just not aware of this landmark data published by Harvard's Frank Sachs? No, they were aware. The chair of the design committee that came up with the DASH diet was Frank Sachs. See, the DASH diet was created with the number one goal of capturing the blood pressure lowering benefits of a vegetarian diet, yet contain enough animal products to make it palatable to the general population. Right? They didn't think the public could handle the truth. Right? Now you can see what they were thinking. Look, just like drugs never work unless you actually take them, diets never work at all unless you actually eat them. So they're like, look, we can't tell people to eat strictly plant-based. No one's going to. So if we create some kind of compromise diet, if we soft pedal the message, then on a population scale, we actually might do more good. Okay. Tell that to the 1,000 American families a day that lose a family member to high blood pressure. Maybe it's time to start telling the American public the truth. There's only one diet that's ever been proven to reverse heart disease in the majority of patients, plant-based diet. Right? Anytime anyone tries to sell you on some new diet they heard about, do me a favor, ask them a simple question. Say, wait a second, has this diet been proven to reverse heart disease, you know, number one reason me and all my loved ones will die? If the answer is no, why would you even consider it? Right? If that's all a plant-based diet can do, reverse the number one killer of men and women, shouldn't that kind of be the default diet until proven otherwise? And the fact that it can also be effective in preventing, arresting, or reversing other leading killers like type 2 diabetes and hypertension would seem to make the case for plant-based eating simply overwhelming. Most deaths in the United States are preventable and related to nutrition. According to the largest study of risk factors ever in human history, this is the Global Burden of Disease Study funded by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, the number one cause of death in the United States and the number one cause of disability in the United States is our diet. Now bumping tobacco smoking to number two, cigarettes now only kill about 500,000 Americans a year, whereas our diet kills hundreds of thousands more. Right? So obviously, nutrition is the number one thing taught in medical schools, right? It's the number one thing your doctor talks to you about when you go see them, right? How could there be such a disconnect between the science and the practice of medicine? Let's do a little thought experiment. Imagine yourself a smoker back in the 1950s. Back in the 1950s, the average per capita cigarette consumption was 4,000 cigarettes a year, meaning the average person walking around smoked half pack a day, just on average. The media was telling people to smoke. Famous athletes agreed. Even Santa Claus wanted you to smoke. I mean, look, you want to keep fit and stay slender, so you make sure to smoke and eat lots of hot dogs to stay trim. and eat lots of sugar to stay slim and trim a lot better than that apple there. I mean, sheesh, right? Though apples do connote goodness and freshness, reads one internal tobacco industry memo, which brings up many possibilities for a youth-oriented cigarette. They want to make apple-flavored cigarettes for kids. For digestion's sake, you smoke. I mean, curative powers claimed by film, but look, better be safe than sorry, and smoke, right? Blow in her face and she'll follow you anywhere. No woman ever says no, there's a round so firm, so fully packed. After all, John Wayne smoked them until he got lung cancer and died. You know, back then, even the paleo folks were smoking. And so were the doctors. Now, this is not to say there wasn't controversy within the medical profession. Sure, some doctors smoked Camels, but other physicians preferred Lucky. So there's a little disagreement. The leader of the U.S. Senate agreed. Who wouldn't want to give their throat a vacation? Not a single case of throat irritation. How could there be when cigarettes are just as pure as the water you drink? Maybe over in Flint, Michigan. But don't worry, if you do get irritated, you can always have your doctor write you a prescription for cigarettes. This is an ad in the Journal of the American Medical Association. So when mainstream medicine is saying smoking on balance may be good for you, when the American Medical Association is saying that, where could you turn back then if you just wanted the facts? What's the new data advanced by science? Well, she was too tired for fun, and then she smoked a Camel. Babe Ruth spoke of proof positive medical science, that is when he still could speak before he died of throat cancer. Now, if by some miracle back then, there was some smokingfacts.org website that could deliver the science directly, bypassing commercially corruptible institutional filters, you would have become aware of studies like this. There's an Adventist study out of California published in 1958 showing non-smokers had at least 90% less lung cancer than smokers. This wasn't the first. When famed surgeon Michael DeBakey was asked why his studies back in the 30s linking lung cancer and smoking were simply ignored, he had to remind people what it was like back then. We were a smoking society. It was in the movies. It was everywhere. Medical meetings were one heavy haze of smoke. Smoking was, in a word, normal. So, back to our thought experiment. If you're a smoker in the 50s in the know, what do you do? I mean, with access to the science, you realize the best available balance of evidence suggests your smoking habit, not so good for you. So, do you change or do you wait? I mean, if you wait until your doctor tells you, between puffs, to quit, you could have cancer by then. Right? If you wait until the powers that be officially recognize it, like the Surgeon General did in the subsequent decade, you could be dead by then. It took more than 7,000 studies and the deaths of countless smokers before the first Surgeon General's report came out against smoking. You'd think maybe after the first 6,000 studies it could have given little people a heads up or something? Powerful industry. Maybe we should have stopped smoking after the 700th study like this. You know, as a smoker in the 50s, on one hand, you had all of society, the government, the medical profession itself telling you to smoke. And on the other, all you had was the science. If you're even aware of studies like this, fast forward 55 years. You know, there's a new Adventist study out of California warning Americans about something else they may be putting in their mouth. Of course, it's not just one study. A recent review found that mortality from all causes put together, including many of our dreaded diseases, stroke, diabetes, cancer, significantly lower among those eating more plant-based diets. Right? So, instead of someone going along with America's smoking habits in the 50s, imagine you or someone you know going along with America's eating habits today. What do? With access to the science, you realize the best available balance of evidence suggests your eating habits are not so great for you. So do you change or do you wait? If you wait until your doctor tells you, between bites, to eat healthier, it could be too late. You know, even after the Surgeon General's report came out, the American Medical Association still dragged their feet. Doctors always seem to be the last on board. In fact, the AMA actually went on record refusing to endorse the Surgeon General's report. Why? Could it have been because they were just handed a $10 million check from the tobacco industry? Maybe. Okay, so we know why the AMA may have been sucking up to the tobacco industry, but wait a second, why weren't individual doctors speaking out? Well, there were a few gallant souls ahead of their time speaking up against industries killing millions, but why not more? Maybe it's because the majority of physicians themselves smoke cigarettes. Just like the majority of physicians today continue to eat foods that are contributing to our epidemic of dietary diseases. What was the AMA's rallying cry back then? Everything in moderation. Extensive scientific studies have proven smoking in moderation, oh, that's fine. Sound familiar? The food industry uses the same tobacco industry tactics. Twisting information, misinformation, twisting the science. The same scientists for hire paid to downplay the risks of cigarettes and toxic chemicals are the same paid for by the National Confectioners Association to downplay the risks of candy, and the same paid by the meat industry to downplay the risks of meat. The consumption of animal foods and processed foods may kill at least 14 million people every year. 14 million people dead. So those of us part of the evidence-based nutrition movement, we're talking about 14 million human lives at stake every year. So, you know, plant-based nutrition can be thought of as kind of the nutritional equivalent of quitting smoking. But how many more people have to die before the CDC says, don't wait for open heart surgery to start eating healthy as well. Until the system changes, we need to take personal responsibility for our own health, for our family's health. We can't wait until society catches up to the science again, because it's a matter of life and death. You know, Dr. Kim Williams became president at the American College of Cardiology last year. He was asked in an interview why he himself follows the same diet he recommends to all his patients, a plant-based diet. I don't mind dying, Dr. Williams replied. I just don't want it to be my own fault. Thank you. For those of you who'd like to see the entire version with the other 12 causes of death I didn't get to talk about, it was videotaped recently at a conference in London. So if you go to bit.ly/London Talk, you can see the entire thing online and share that link with your friends. I also have copies of How Not to Die Here. All proceeds from the sale of my books all go to charity. And all my work is available free at nutritionfacts.org. Questions? So, so the question is about accountability within the medical profession. How can they get away with this? And the reason is primarily, in my experience, ignorance. Doctors just don't know about this entire body of evidence. We weren't taught it in school. We weren't taught it in medical school. We weren't taught it in postgraduate medical education. We're not taught it in continuing medical education. So doctors are simply ignorant. They just don't know about the power of nutrition can have for combating chronic disease, which typically, that's like 80% of what a primary care doc sees are these kind of chronic diseases that tend to get worse, then you die. And here is a tool that they've been missing from their medical toolbox that allows patients to actually get better. And so that's what I've experienced, what I've seen, is it really kind of, can reignite that spark of what led them to go into medicine in the first place. Look, if they wanted to make a lot of money, they become stockbrokers or something. You go into medicine because you want to take care of sick people. You want to help people. But it's very frustrating to practice medicine these days because so much of the death and disease are these chronic diseases for which we have little we can do. But there's actually this entire body of evidence suggesting we can really help these people. And so it's a really positive, optimistic message. I speak at hospitals and medical conferences all over. And the reaction is not, you're going to take away my business because half my business is blood pressure checks. And if everyone doesn't have high blood pressure, my second BMW is never going to, right? No. You get this really like, wow. That's amazing. Wow. And people change their entire practices around. And so it's really a matter, I think, of just education. And it's interesting, when you speak at these conferences, now there are entire plant-based nutrition medical conferences where you have hundreds of practitioners all over the country talking about, well, how do you make it work in your practice? How do you get reimbursed? And when I ask them, well, where did you find out about this stuff? Hoping they'll all say, nutritionfacts.org. But no, they never say that. What they say is, I had a patient. They had a patient who took their own health in their own hands and said, I've got to figure this out, right? I've had heart disease in the family, I don't want to die like my uncle did, and they look it up and they find this kind of material, and then they start making these healthy changes in their own life. They go to their doctor, they get their cholesterol rechecked, and the doctor's like, oh, we got to send another blood to the lab. It's totally messed up, obviously. And then it's like, wow, what did you do? And the patient says, I don't know, I ate some broccoli, And that's what did it. It was one of their own patients. Like, I can give them a stack of papers this big, but it's that personal, like, they've been following this patient forever. They know their whole family. And, someone's got diabetes, and nothing's worked. They've tried all the drugs. They got side effects of one drug, throw another drug on top. And then all of a sudden, they're getting better, right? And it's not just your numbers getting better, but they're feeling better. Your energy is up, your digestion is better, your sleep is better, your periods are better. All down the line. And then it's like, wow. And so then they start telling everybody else, and they get resources, and then they find the website, and then they... So you could be that patient. So when you say, I don't want to go to my doctor, they're just going to, No, we need you to. If all of you don't go to the doctor, then the doctors aren't going to learn about this stuff. So we should go share this information, and hopefully they will jump at the opportunity to improve their practice. Caution with the consumption of oils. So I encourage people to eat not a vegetarian diet, not a vegan diet. I encourage people to eat an evidence-based diet. What does that mean? Well, the best available balance of evidence suggests the healthiest diet is one centered around whole plant foods, right? Fruits, vegetables, legumes, beans, split peas, chickpeas, lentils, whole grains, nuts and seeds, mushrooms, herbs and spices, all those wonderful foods grow out of the ground. Real food, wonderful. Okay, so that's not just animal foods, it's processed foods too. We want to ideally reduce our intake of processed foods as much as possible, and oiled processed foods. So you take something like a walnut, right? It's packed with nutrition. You remove all the nutrition, you're left with walnut oil. It's like when you take a beet and you remove all the nutrition, you're left with table sugar. Most sugar comes from beets these days, right? You took a really healthy food, remove all the nutrition, you're left with sugar. So oil is like the table sugar of the fat kingdom, right? And just like you wouldn't eat spoonfuls of sugar because it's like the calories, but no nutrition, empty calories. Oil is kind of like empty calories. In fact, it's even more concentrated. So a tablespoon of oil, it's like 100 calories, 120 calories. You know how much 100 calories of broccoli is? 100 calories of tomatoes? 100 calories of strawberries. It's a big overflowing bowl of strawberries, right? If you had a tablespoon of oil, you wouldn't even feel full. You wouldn't feel anything, right? But if you had a big thing, oh, all right. So I encourage people to, you know, try to stick to whole foods whenever possible. And there's lots of wonderful recipes and techniques. And like you say, well, wait a second, how could I saute without? Oh, there's all sorts of ways you can. There's lots of ways you can cook without oil. And so then you're just maximizing the nutrient density of your diet. You get more nutrition per calorie, which is associated with better health outcomes. Oh, okay. So soy protein isolate. The last word, isolate, should give you, right? It's isolated soy protein. So they took a soybean and they removed everything but the protein, and then they use it and put it in, make it protein powders or whatever. So perfectly healthy source of protein. But wouldn't we're losing all that nutrition. I mean, it's like you're being robbed. Someone came along, took all the nutrition. What? And you paid for it. What? So even something like tofu. Like tofu is a processed food, so you take a soybean, you remove half the fiber, half the minerals, you're left with tofu. Now, soybeans are so incredibly healthy, you can remove half the nutrition, still have a really healthy food. But even healthier, like tempeh, you look at tempeh, you actually see the individual soybeans there, it's a whole soy food. Or edamame, the green immature soybeans, you can just eat out of the pod, right? So those are the healthiest, again, always trying to eat healthier. Now the role I see these kind of soy protein isolates, these like some of these fake meat products like you have out here, the role I see is for transition, right? Not everybody. So if you've been wrestling pigs all your life, right? And you've been, you know, and it's all burgers and milkshakes. Like literally people eat this, right? And then someone comes in and says, oh, have a salad, right? Or, I mean, they can't even wrap their head around it, right? But instead of saying, hey, instead of having that burger, have this burger. Instead of having that hot dog, have this hot dog. And, you know, you can't really, I mean, it's gotten so good. Instead of having that ice cream, have this ice cream. And so less saturated fat, less cholesterol, right? So better, right? Ideally, but we just don't want people to stall there, right? We want people to continue to move towards eating even healthier along this entire spectrum. But I think they're great transition foods to get kind of one's family on board and familiar tastes, familiar, you know, and then keep moving them healthy. We can all continue to move on that spectrum towards healthier and healthier foods. So if you have a genetic predisposition to getting oxalate kidney stones, you need to cap the amount of oxalates you're getting in a day. And for most people, that means just cutting out the three high oxalate vegetables, which is beet greens, Swiss chard, and spinach. So just basically. But for everybody else, those are perfectly wonderfully healthy foods. Some people, their kidneys cannot deal with oxalates as efficiently, and they can build up as stones, which is a very painful phenomenon. So if you already had an oxalate kidney stone, family history of oxalate kidney stones, you may want to limit your oxalate intake, but for everybody else, eat your greens. Even for people if you have oxalate problems, eat your greens, just different greens. Yeah. So the question was, it's not us medical professionals that are to blame. It's big pharma, right? Okay, but big pharma isn't prescribing those drugs. We are, right? The doctors are. But now, of course, they play a role in medical education and practice. They play an overwhelming role. How we were taught, what we get at medical conferences, what we get in the mail, all the junk mail every day from big pharma. We have people visiting us in our offices, trying to knock at the door, give us free samples, and, you know, and if that's all they do, then we'd be happy. Free Caribbean vacations, we get enough prescriptions, whatever, okay. But it's still, I mean, but the, You know, I mean, they do that because they know it works. They don't do it because they love giving away money. They do it because they think it'll get people to change their prescribing habits, and it does seem to. So I would love, indeed, to see this, you know, to see a better divide between, and remove some of the influence. There shouldn't be ads on TV for drugs, like in most countries of the world. I mean, there's lots of things we can do to improve and kind of restrain in. So I think the U.S. uses 70, 80% of the drugs in the entire world. We have like, you know, 5, 10% of the population, 5% of the world's population, and use 80% of the, are we that much sicker than everybody else? I mean, no, there are these kind of, these financial incentives woven into our for-profit medical system that makes drugs kind of the go-to choice, and a lot of that has to do with big pharma, but we're bright individuals, we should be critical thinkers, and we should only use drugs and surgery as the last resort, if there are, particularly for lifestyle diseases, in my opinion. This is, all right, high level question, are you ready? I love this, this is a great opportunity. You know, it's funny, the difference in questions I get coming to a learned audience like this compared to speaking at medical conferences. I was at a, it's funny. So I went to a, this was a couple of years ago now, I'll answer your question, but a couple of years ago now, I spoke at a dietitian conference. So all dietetic, like every state has their own, like, you know, Wisconsin Dietetic Association, there's a national one as well, and they all have annual conferences, and I was so excited to be invited to the first annual conference at this state, and so I went there and I was like, okay, now these people, you know, all they've done is they studied, you know, dietetics their whole life. This is going to be a really high-level audience, and so I can't give my, like, regular stuff I give to doctors who don't know any nutrition, right? I mean, doctors know as much as kind of typical lay on it, so, but this is going to be high level. So we're talking biochemistry, whipped out the Krebs cycle, again, the whole deal, right? Okay. And so I gave this high level talk, and then, right, ready for questions, right? And that questions are the best part, because you can really flex your knowledge. Anyone can memorize a script. Someone asks a question, but then you can be like, oh, well, page 642 on this journal. Okay. So first question goes up. They're all dietitians, and she asks, wait a second, are you counting chicken as meat? Seriously? I was just like, oh, totally misjudged this audience. Okay, let's bring it on back down. Oh. Anyway, so the question is, what about advanced glycation end products found, which are formed when basically high protein fatty foods are exposed to high temperatures? You get these advanced glycation end products. I've got a bunch of videos and a bunch more videos. The evidence is mounting, role in diabetes and inflammation and all sorts of things, bad things that we want to avoid. And you look at these tables, so, you know, so I talk about the top 20 sources, right? And it's like chicken McNuggets and, you know, all these, you know, on down, sausage, chicken, fish, okay. But if you look at these tables, and I show the tables, and give links to all the tables, there are a few plant foods that have high too. So mention broiled tofu. What does tofu have it? Tofu has a lot of protein and fat, you broil it, you get the grill lines going. And you just created advanced glycation end products at really high levels. Same thing with nuts. When you roast your nuts, what does nuts have? Lots of protein and fat. You roast your nuts, and like roasted walnuts are just like, oh, so, you know, your whole kitchen smells good, tastes so much better, freshly roasted nuts. Ugh. But what do they have? Lots of AGEs, these so-called glycotoxins. And so one of the things that I have personally changed within my family's diet recently, in fact, I don't even think it made it into the book. So this is after the book, is that, you know, this new paper came out talking about AGEs and nuts, so I no longer roast my nuts. So I no longer toast my nuts. I don't know why that's... I eat my nuts raw. I don't like them as much. They don't taste as good. But, I mean, so that's a legitimate. So what I would say to you is is don't broil your tofu, or more is if you're gonna eat, if you love your broiled tofu, special occasions, doesn't matter what you eat in your birthday, your holidays, it's the day-to-day stuff that adds up, and on a day-to-day basis, we really shouldn't be eating broiled tofu just because of the AGEs. Thank you for that question. Great question. Yes.
GMOs?
Yes. What about genetically modified organisms? Got a bunch of videos on GM, on the latest science of GMOs. Just type in GMO. So like all the, oh, there's a little search bar up here. So all the like controversy, like gluten and GMOs, there's all a series of videos on all of them. I can give you the short little snippet. So for GMOs, we have no human data suggesting harm for the actual genetic elements themselves. However, they have been, genetically modified foods do have higher levels of pesticide residues. And that's because that's what they're genetically modified to do, is withstand a particular pesticide. So for example, GMO soy, you know, they can heavily spray soy crops. Before they couldn't. They could just spray between crops because otherwise you'd kill the soy plant. But we genetically modified soybeans to resist a particular pesticide, which is sold by the same company that gives you the soybeans, ironically. And then you can blanket the fields while the soy is standing, right? You could heavily pesticide. And so actually, so when you at the store level, when you measure pesticide residues, then you have much higher levels in the GMO soy compared to conventional soy or organic soy, conventional non-GMO soy. Now, the store they went to is a feed store. GMO soy is pretty much just fed to food animals. I mean, the soy, like the tofu that you're not grilling, is typically organic, and by law, by 2002 USDA standard, cannot have any GMOs. So if you want to avoid GMOs, you stick to organic soy. But yeah, most organic, GMO soy is just fed to farm animals because it's cheaper to produce. Well, right. So if you eat the livestock, might you get more? It's actually a type of pesticide that isn't built, that doesn't build up in the fat. So unlike organochlorine pesticides like DDT and things where it does get higher and higher and higher as you go up the food chain, but still, by sticking with the lowest rung of the food chain, the plant kingdom, you minimize your intake of these so-called organic pollutants in general, PCBs, dioxins, etc. And if you measure the blood, the level of pollutants in the blood of people eating plant-based diets, always in all studies, found to be the lowest compared to any other population group, just because they're eating at the bottom of the food chain. Okay, so what about the great soy debate? The soy debate only exists on the internet. There's no debate in the medical literature, or at least there wasn't. There was until 2012, where we had the first study on. So the concern with soy, the theoretical concern, has been there's these phytoestrogens in soy, right? So yeah, soy is great for treating menopausal symptoms like hot flashes because it has these like estrogen-like compounds, but wait a second, what about breast cancer risk? What if you have breast cancer? What if you're on a drug like tamoxifen that's whole purpose in life is to suppress estrogen? Do you want to be eating all this estrogen-like compounds? And there were studies on one type of rodent that said it was good, one study of the other type of rodent said it was bad. We didn't have human studies until 2012. And since then, there's been 5 studies involving literally thousands of breast cancer survivors. Effectively, there's the breast cancer survivors that ate soy versus those that didn't eat soy, asking 2 simple questions. Who lives longer? And who has the lowest rate of cancer coming back, cancer recurrence? And in every single one of those studies, 5 out of 5, I can't tell what to feed your hamster, but 5 out of 5 human studies, every single one showed the women that ate soy lived longer and had a lower recurrence rate. And all the evidence in terms of prevention, you have about 30 to 50% lower risk of getting breast cancer in the first place if you eat soy, particularly starting in adolescence. It's a good time to eat soy. So now if you look at the literature, they're saying not just we have to stop, now they're encouraging women with breast cancer to eat soy regardless whether they have estrogen receptor positive or negative breast cancer, whether they're on tamoxifen or not, in every subgroup. They all did better, and we now know why. There's 2 types of estrogen receptors. There's alpha receptors, beta receptors. Our own estrogen is preferentially attached to the alpha receptors, so the soy phytoestrogens attached to the beta receptors. So the effect that soy has depends on the relative distribution of these two receptors in each in all the tissues of our bodies. That's why that soy can have a pro-estrogenic effect in some tissues, such as strengthening bones or preventing hot flash symptoms. Those are pro-estrogenic effects, and have anti-estrogenic effects in other tissues, like lowering breast cancer risk. So it's what's called a SERM, selective estrogen receptor modulator. So it kind of get the best worlds, best of both worlds, when you eat soy or other phytoestrogen-rich foods such as flax seeds. I encourage people to eat a tablespoon of ground flax seeds a day. And we are signing books. I'll see you out there. Thank you so much.